You in numbers, large and spare, how about that?
Start to say, speak up, or so many of us in here, we can't hear nothing.
Let's turn to 379.
379.
We're still here to worship. Two or three are gathered in his name.
That's right.
Let us see Jesus in you.
Heavenly Father, we praise you, my Lord Jesus. And we want to thank you for each and every one that's here tonight, my Lord. For we know we seek you each and every day of our lives. That you give us guidance. That you give us knowledge and wisdom to lead the lost to you. To your love and glory, my Heavenly Father. So that we all can spend eternity in heaven with you. For you are the greatest thing that has ever been in our lives. You forgive us for each and everything that we do each and every day. You walk with us through the hard times and the sad times. Lord, how could we live without you? For you are the only thing and the only answer to each and everyone's lives. And God be with Brother Mike as he gives his sermon tonight, my Lord. That the message will touch our hearts to draw us even closer to you. Because we love you, my Heavenly Father. And I pray these things in your sweet, precious, holy name, my Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Now one more now. Number 206. 206. This song on the Baptist Star one morning. Kenny Griffin was on there with his church, and I think it was the first time he was on the Baptist Star for New Salem. I'm sure he was nervous, and he played this song. He played one of the gospel band songs from our CD, and then he played this, and boy, it just rolled me over. And I fell in love with it, so I'm going to do it tonight. I Can Trust Jesus. God picked up that can no longer fight. He brushed off his wounds
watched it soar into the sky. If he's mindful of creation, on this I can depend. I am his child, and I can place all my trust in him. I can trust Jesus. I can trust Jesus. He never once has failed to meet my needs. He my strong tower, the strength at my weakest hour. I can trust Jesus, he takes care of me. I have prayed some prayers and felt they never were heard, but I held to God's hand and kept right on trusting in his word. My wants and God's desires don't always agree, but I lean on his will, for he always knows what's best for me. I can trust Jesus. I can trust Jesus. He never once has failed to meet my needs. He is my strong tower, the strength and my weakest hour. I can trust Jesus, he takes care of me. I can trust Jesus, he takes care of me. Yes, he is my strong tower, the strength and my weakest hour. I can trust Jesus, he takes care. I can trust Jesus, 'cause he takes care of me.
Eric does a good job. Sometimes I say, let's drive this way. Okay. Never has talked back. Very rarely ever talks. somebody, and I forget who asked for this song then tonight, so we're going to do it tonight. I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above. If I could count all the blessings from the storehouse above, I simply ask for the favor of him beyond mortal men. I'm sure he would grant it again and again. I want to
to stroll all over heaven with you sometimes. When all the troubles and heartaches are truly vanished away, and when the joy of the beauty where all things are new, I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below. Time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of rapture, together we'll surely be. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
Come here.
I want to stroll over heaven with you, so glad there. And all the woes and heartaches are vanished away. The friends we once knew, then we'll meet all our loved ones, and we'll meet Jesus too, and that will be a glad reunion, and there'll be much to do while I stroll over heaven with you.
Look at
that. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all the troubles and heartaches vanished away, and with the joy of the beauty where all things are new, I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
This song here was my mother-in-law's favorite song that I'd done. It's tonight, pray for me.
Send down a blessing over me, and I'll do the same. When I'm praying for you, we all need loving care, and our names just mentioned in prayer. When the storms, trouble I see, is all that we can see. Yes, in the bad times and good times and sad times, pray for me. I need the prayer.
And ripped it in half.
Lighten it up, it's just a little too heavy for me. Good evening, guys.
Good evening.
I shared with you this morning, we'd be talking about the bride. That has changed a little bit. Sometimes as I get into that study, I get led in a different direction. So we will talk about that a little bit. There's been something that was confusing to me, and this is one of those things that I felt revealed to me today in my study. You ever have that? You're just not, there's something in the Word of God that you're not sure about, and then it just, your eyes are opened, you see it. I've looked for timelines on the book of Revelation, from beginning to end, from the seven churches or the church age to the seals being opened, to the vials being opened, the wrath of God and His judgment, second coming, and there are various things. We've gone through a lot already in this study. I've learned a lot. This one thing, and we'll get to this in just a minute. We talked about, I don't think it was last Sunday, it would have been Sunday night, we talked about those things that prompt us to praise. As we saw the seven vials opened up the week before, God's power being revealed, His judgment, the host of heaven praising Him in that power, and those things that prompt us to praise. Well, here we have things leading up to that final judgment. I know we kind of jump around, so I have to refocus us on where we're at, so that we don't get things out of order and confused. So we've learned a lot of terminology. We've learned about some major events. So here we are. I don't know where we'll lead to next week, but I think we're going to finish out Revelations in a couple of weeks, and then we'll go back to the beginning and look at the seven churches. I know it's different, it's strange, it's not normal. I just share it, I don't make it up. But anyway, in chapter 18 of Revelation, where we'll be tonight, we look at, just vaguely mention, fall of Babylon. Mentioned as a great city, more than a great city, in scriptures, this is as what we've come to find out to be the apostate church, that which is not the genuine church, but something like the church. This is a church that has aligned many people. It has changed the doctrine of the Bible, even argue that the day of which we worship has been changed by this church. But that we can argue as to when the Sabbath day is, whether it be Saturday, Sunday. Some of the other things that I find out is the Jewish calendar was based on a lunar calendar that had a certain number of days. We base our calendar on a solar calendar that has more days per year. So the reality is, the Sabbath would not fall on Saturday, every Saturday of our calendar year. It would be different. So we might be worshiping on Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, at various times. And I can't remember, it's been a little while back since I looked at this, but there will be a time coming soon where those actually line up for a short time. You guys ever see your windshield wipers? You know how they do this, and then they kind of fall into place for a little bit and mess up. That's kind of what that calendar will do. If I could generalize it for you, because I'm not scholared in that or schooled in that. So we'll just take it as that. But what we look at, as I looked at this, there is something to be said in regards to this church, this false church being done away with and how it affects the people. And I can only imagine what this would actually look like in that time. I believe that we as the church are already called out of this world, and as we look at those vials being opened and that final judgment being poured out by those angels and the destruction that this earth is going to experience, there's not very many people that are going to survive those events. However, there will be some. The Bible talks about a remnant. We're going to get to that in just a minute. There's somebody that's going to come out of heaven on a white horse that's going to take care of that. He's going to prepare this world, make it inhabitable for his redeemed one more time. But in the scripture, there's a couple of verses that in verse 18. In verse 8 of chapter 18, it says, "Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death, mourning, and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth her." This is in regards to that apostate church, the Babylonian church. "And the kings of earth who have committed fornication and live deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her." They're going to miss her. They have a great share, the leaders of this world have at that time, will have a great share in the wealth of that church. This is the wealthiest, most richest body in the world. "They will lament when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, Alas, alas, the great city Babylon, the mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment." This is a time when all of the finances will come to nothing. There will be no value there. The ivory, the jewels, the everything of value will come to nothing. It will be gone in a moment's notice, or within an hour's time, it says. People are going to be crying out over the smoke and loss of this system, basically. They're going to be pained. Have you ever been kind of awestruck over losing something that was important to you? You just kind of stand there like, what do we do now? This is what economies are going to be. They're just, those that have put their trust in something that is false, it's going to be revealed to them that they have followed false teachings. It's going to be made aware to them, and they're just going to be standing there, and they're going to realize once and for all, we've made a mistake. But it's too late. As we go a little bit farther into chapter 19, if you read through chapter 18, it's very straightforward. There's not much figuratism in that, but it talks about the loss of that church and those that have put their faith in it, and how they're going to bewail and their time is cut off. In chapter 19, the scripture reads, "And after these things," I love what this is called in verse 1 in my Bible. It has a heading called the Hallelujah Chorus in Heaven. "And after these things I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, for he hath judged the great whore which did corrupt the earth with her fornication and hath avenged the blood of his servants at her hand." This is what we're talking about. This is what's happened. She's experiencing her punishment for misleading and the slaying of martyrs and the saints at her hand. Verse 3. "And again they said, Hallelujah. And her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the 4 beasts fell down and worshiped God that sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters. and as the voice of mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. It's like there's one group after another group. I don't know what you would call that in a chorus, but one sounds out, Alleluia, praise be to God, and the next one is kind of chiming in afterwards, and they're all joining together. It, many times in the scripture, when you see this many voices or many waters, praises, it is in reference to the saints of God, those that are believers that have been called up into heaven. This is the believers. This is us, this great multitude, the host of heaven, along with the angels and all those who have been delivered. Verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he has said unto me, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When we look at this, we can look back. One thing, and we look back at some of the parables. Excuse me. Frog in my throat. We look back at some of the parables that talk about marriage in the scriptures. The marriage ceremony, where there was a calling or gathering of those to come into the wedding. And then we also remember or reminded of the 10 virgins that went out with their lamps. Some were ready, some were not. Some were with something, which being representing the Holy Spirit. Some were without, those that were not of Christ. We see that there is a waiting period, a time. When you look back, there's two different types of wedding ceremonies that would have been observed in order, or betrothals, espousement, times that really more in depth. It's not like, hey, mom and dad, I want you to meet this girl that I've fallen in love with. We're going to get married. It wasn't like that. There might have been a time, and there's two different systems and way this worked. One would be if you fell in love with that person, and if a man laid with a woman and then gave her money, today we would call that what?
Prostitution.
Well, that's not exactly, I don't know if that's where somebody got the idea from or not, but the idea was if that man laid with her, he became married to her. that was it. Ball and chain began at that point, right? No. But the idea is that it was important. That represented the joining of those two. Then there had to be a giving of something to show that commitment, a purchasing of that woman. The man was required to purchase them. Now, for most, and was the general rule, the marriages were more arranged. It was believed, and I believe this to be true, that when a man was born of heaven, his spouse was announced at that same time. You've heard it called a soulmate. Two people joined together before they were even born. From the beginning of time, God had commanded it into existence. Wow, what if we actually took that much time today to seek out who God has for us? By the way, men, the wife, the woman that you have is given to you by God. Beautiful way that he figures this out, because we need all the help we can get, right? Who are we to choose, right? We mess up every time. It's a good thing he sends them to us so that we understand what he's done. The other way, let me get back on track here. The other way is that as wife was betrothed, the husband or the husband's family would go and pay or purchase her with money or animals or some sort of duty. And then there would be a time period, usually about a year from that time, that they would get married. He would go to meet them, see if I can go to meet with her and bring her to a place that he had prepared for her. And that's where they would spend all eternity, or their lives together, I should say. Now, getting two things crossed up here. Eternity is for the believer, marriage is for life, right? That's what God does part. For most of that, that's what we give as our vows. What we see is like a three-phased event, as was tradition. The betrothal, the espousement, or what we would consider the engagement time for a couple today, and then the actual marriage, them being joined together for their life. We see that in the church today. As we look at this, we see phase one being Christ purchasing his bride with his shed blood on the cross. We see the second and his, I have to be very careful with these words, and I'll have to explain these a little bit later because this is where I get confused. The second would be in the taking up of his church, bringing them into heaven, right? That would be the espousal period. That's where the church is somewhat together, but some separate. After final judgment, we know that they're all brought together as one group. That's the marriage supper, so to speak. Then there is Christ's return. Now let me explain this, because this is where it gets confusing for many, even for myself, because a lot of times these are interchanged. Christ's return, he takes up his bride. But then I look on other timelines and I see where at this point is where the church is called up after tribulation. But we know that through the scriptures, in many ways, we have learned that the church is taken out of this world before tribulation happens. So it can't be both. So, in a likewise manner, as Christ was received out of this world into heaven, he will return. The Bible tells us that the clouds enveloped him, and he was out of sight into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. We know that in a likewise manner, the skies are going to open, Jesus will be revealed. Now, the scripture doesn't say that he is going to set foot on earth at that point. That's not a full return, is it? So see, we have to be very careful at how we read, because that's what I've always been heard. That there was that his second coming was at that point, and that this other time would be, well, there was confusion. I tried to share this with Lynn to try, because this is what clarified it for me a little bit. If I said that we're inviting Gene and Marietta to come over and have dinner. Well, we've invited them, but you haven't actually come until you show up. You haven't come to our house until you're there. So the reality is this, that coming or revealing of Christ was not his return to earth. His first coming was as a babe, right? His second coming was with power and majesty, and with a host of angels. That's what we look at. That second coming is not a rapture or a second rapture or a third. This is that final judgment. It has already happened. He, and it's hard for us to understand, because in this world, the marriage is all about the bride. And we have a tendency to look at it from the perspective of this marriage is all about his church. But at this point, it's not about the church. It's about him. It's the marriage supper of the Lamb, not the bride. So we look at the terminology and we see that there's definitely a difference between the one and the other. And like I said, for this has been a confusing thing because it's been thrown back and forth all my life, one thing or another. And it's one of those things that was just, it was revealed or something that I understood as I read this. Here in verse 11, we see the Lamb in his return. We see him stepping out of heaven. If you look a couple of chapters back, you see the Antichrist also coming onto the scene with a white horse. There's some discussion as to whether that's Antichrist or Jesus, but at the when you see everything compared, it has to be Antichrist. It's got to be. There's no confusion. I want to make sure of that so that I don't confuse this as well. We saw the four horsemen of the apocalypse. That one who rode the white horse was the one who went out conquering, but he was not doing it in Jesus' name. It was for his own glory, to build up his power on earth. This is Jesus on a white horse. On verse 11, I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. As we go down through here, you're going to see that there's no mistaking who is riding this horse. Maybe you figured it out already. He doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself, and was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. You go with me to... Bear with me here. Make sure I'm right before I say it. John chapter 1. John chapter 1. We know who the Word of God is. When we see this statement, his name is the Word of God, we know him no other than Jesus himself, the Word becoming flesh. In John chapter 1, the scripture reads, "In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of all men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." We go down into a little bit farther to the next time where we see the Word mentioned in verse 14. The Bible tells us, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." John is the one who bare witness of him and cried out in the wilderness, I am the forerunner of Christ." We know who this is about. This is the bridegroom. He is making ready a place for his bride. The Word of God. Go over to verse 14 and look at what there is. This is an event. I mean, this is heaven has already praised and glorified him. Chapter 19, verse 14 is where I'll be going from there. Revelation. Back to Revelation. This event, I mean, this is, we don't see Jesus stepping out of heaven. The first time, he comes as a helpless babe, born in a manger. This time, something very different. You see those, what's that description again? His eyes were as flame of fire, and his head were many crowns, and he had a name written, and no man knew but himself. He's not coming alone. The armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. You know, I don't know for certain, but I believe that same description is given to the believers, the great multitude, that John turns around and sees them dressed in white and holding palms in their hands, representing us, the church. I don't know if we're going to go out into battle and do this, but I think that we know that the host of heaven, the angels, will be. In verse 15, out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations. Excuse me, guys. My eyes are getting tired. That with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of his fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. No mistaking who this is that is stepping out of heaven and who is bringing all things to completion. Verse 17, and I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains and the flesh of the mighty men and the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them. The flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horses and against his army. If I pause there for just a second, I would say this is the most valiant, wasted effort mankind has ever tried. To go and wage war against Jesus himself. They don't have any. Those that are left, this remnant, that which they have believed in has just been destroyed. They have no hope of heaven. Anything else. This is a desperate move of those that remain. Wasted effort completely. Who can stand against the Son of God? My Bible tells me there's no power greater than him. So everything in this world must be over. Matthew 24, verse 30. You don't have to turn there. I've got it typed out here. Hopefully I have it typed correctly. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. As we talked about this, we've talked about those two areas of heaven. The Old Testament saints that have been brought up to a place in heaven called paradise. And then the other part of heaven where we that have died since Christ died on the cross, we've gone. There's going to be this reuniting at this point. We're going to be gathered together. I believe this is speaking of that same time. Bringing together one bride into that marriage ceremony. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, if you can go up there and read with me. It's a little bit more lengthy. Second Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. What an event this is going to be. There's a remnant has gone through tribulation and struggles and signs in the skies and experienced the wrath of God, and yet they still haven't turned to him. He's left with no choice but to reap that remnant, to remove them from the earth. My Bible tells me that he is going to create for us a new heaven and a new earth where we will live with him for all eternity.